Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to my channel. Today we are going to discuss some more things related to organization theory. We already discussed organization theory in the past two or three sessions, and today I'm going to talk about certain more theorists which were connected with organization theory and who gave certain theories which led to the evolution and development of organization theory. All these things are very important and hold a lot of importance for the upcoming examinations, and I'm going to try and explain it in as simple language as possible so that you don't find cracking those questions at all difficult. So let us start with the session. So today we are going to start with neoclassical theory or human relations approach. In the last class, we started with the classical theorists and we talked about three major theorists, Taylor, Fayol and Max Weber. Let us jump directly to human relation approach, which actually developed as a reaction to the problems faced under the classical theories by the classical theorists. The major problem that they were facing was that humans were not given importance at all. And what regarding humans? The social systems that humans create through communication, through regular relationships, and all those things were being ignored by the classical theorists. So the new classical theorists identified that, okay, these theories are missing out on an important aspect which leads to either development and growth of organizations or failure of organizations. And this particular characteristic is humans, how humans behave in organizations and why do they behave as they do. So trying to identify the reasons behind failure or success of organizations and providing the importance of humans and their social systems in the organization became the center point of discussion under neoclassical theorists or human relation approach. George Elton Mayo is considered as the father of human relations approach, and he came out with his theories based on Hawthorne experiments or studies which were carried out at Western Electric Company. The focus, as I said, has been on human beings in the organizations, and human beings develop informal relationships in an organization. So the importance indirectly is on informal relationships within an organization. Elton Mayo carried out a lot of experiments under an umbrella term of Hawthorne experiments. Number one, illumination experiment. Number two, relay assembly room experiment. And number three, bank wiring experiment. The mass interview program was also carried out, but these three are normally considered as the most important one, but you can mention or remember, try and remember all the four as well. The illumination experiment briefly said, let me put it out briefly in front of you. The illumination experiment tried to see the reaction of people or reaction of workers in a room when the lighting in the room is changed. So for example, there are certain workers who require extensive use of eyes. Therefore, they need good lighting. So under illumination experiment, Elton Mayo tried to reduce the lighting first or increase the lighting first and then reduce it and see the reaction on productivity of the workers working in that room. But he found out that productivity is not at all dependent upon physical conditions such as lighting, but productivity instead was being affected by their psychological and social conditions. So if there are five workers working in that particular room, let's say three workers are a part of group one, which is being created based on their likes and dislikes, and two workers have come together and formed another group two. Now, if one of these workers is pushed out and taken to another department or another room for some other work, then the remaining worker out here, his productivity also goes down. So something like that happened. That is, instead of lighting or physical conditions affecting their productivity, it was the social and psychological conditions of these humans which affected or which had an impact on their productivity. The relay assembly room was another one wherein the productivity was mentioned, was actually recorded, and changes were seen when the pauses in the rest pauses were increased or decreased. So basically, whenever the workers working in that room or in that department were being forced to take certain extra rest pauses or to do something that they did not want to do, then their productivity went down. So workers' output increased as a response to attention, feeling of being important, and non-directive supervision. So whenever their supervision was non-directive in nature, then their productivity went up, and whenever the superiors tried to control their behavior and their movements, then the productivity started going down. As you can see, this is directly in contrast with what Elton, with what Taylor had said, wherein he had said that we should be identifying the right movements and the right number of movements of every worker in the organization so that his productivity can be increased. For example, if there is this person A who is putting on tires in a Maruti plant on the Maruti vehicles. So if he is required to take, let's say for putting every tire, he is required to, so for example, this is the relay assembly, okay, the car is here and he has to, let's say, make one round of picking up the tools, getting it here, putting on the tires, then going to the other side and putting on the other tires and then coming back. So total of 3 rounds he is making in one, in putting on 2 tires, okay, in one car, 2 tires, 3 rounds. So this is the optimal movement that he is required to make in order to put 2 tires in a car. Now, according to Taylor, this should not increase or decrease, because if it changes, then the productivity is expected to go down. But as per Elton Mayo, there should not be any directive as to how many times you're supposed to move or what you're supposed to do, how many rests you're supposed to take, otherwise that directive supervision will reduce the productivity of the worker. The third one is bank wiring experiment. Let's talk about that as well very briefly. Okay, so in bank wiring experiment, the result was that individual performance and motivation is determined by group norms. What this how this was achieved is that it was seen that the productivity of workers did not increase directly if the payment incentives was increased. For example, if payment per hour was rupees 100, but it was decided to increase it to 120 per hour, the productivity of every worker did not increase as a result. Why? Because the group of workers, not the individuals, the group of workers which was more heavy in influencing the behavior of individual workers determined that this increase in rate of 120 per hour from 100 per hour might actually be bad for the workers, because they felt that the organization, because if it is paying more, it would want to hire some unproductive people. So if there are 5 people in the group, 5 workers in the group, they assumed that 2 of us might get fired in the short run, because the workers are expected to work more for getting more payment, and therefore the workers who are less efficient, less productive, they would certainly get fired. So the group would decide that we will not increase our productivity, we will focus on working as per the old norms only. So it the result was, or the conclusion was, that increasing the incentives did not necessarily increase the productivity of workers, because the performance motivation of individual workers is decided by group norms. And then there was mass interview, which was very simple, which said that interview is very important. Not directed, but non-directive interviews are very important, because they provide a mechanism for the employees to release their emotions, to vent out onto the management or the organization, and it provides an informal method of creating a relationship with the between the interviewer and the interviewee. Okay, so mass interview program resulted, although Hawthorne studies did not do anything under mass interview, by just taking interviews Elton Mayo saw that the productivity increased simultaneously. Okay, so the conclusions are important because these terms are important. You do not have to, even if you don't understand the conclusions, don't worry about it, because if you read it 2-3 times, you will be able to understand. It's very easy to understand, but these keywords, these terms are very important. They can be directly framed in the examination, or if you have to write something, then mentioning these keywords holds a lot of importance. Number one, social capacity, which means that amount of work is not determined just by the physical capacity, but also by social capacity, which came directly from the first experiment, that was illumination experiment. Non-economic rewards play a central role in determining motivation and productivity. This is the last one that we just discussed, that economic rewards does not necessarily result in more productivity, because individual behavior and performance is determined largely by group norms. Specialization does not necessarily result in an efficient worker. Why? Because specialization results in monotony, and specialization makes an employee feel that he is being told what is to be done. Workers react in groups, not as individuals. We've understood this. Importance of informal communications and leadership systems in an organization, discuss this. Informal communications are considered important. As per Mayo, decentralization was advocated, flat structure was suggested against tall structure. And the major criticism of human relations approach was that it was termed as happiness boys by the critics, who said that Elton Mayo has just focused on the humans in the organization without creating any sync between what these humans are doing and what the organization wants to achieve. So these humans are not sitting in a park and strolling around. They are working in an organization. The organization is giving them money. They are being paid, so they are expected to do something in return, to provide something in return productive to the organization, so that they can make profits, they can make enough revenues to be able to pay them and survive in the long run. So Elton Mayo, instead of focusing on the sync between organization's needs and the human's needs, focused only on humans, and that's the major criticism, wherein it said, the critics said that they have, by focusing only on humans, they have converted organizations into happiness boys, wherein the humans, the workers working in the organizations are happy, but the organizations are not making money at all, so their survival is hindered. Okay, so this was the major criticism of human relations approach. Next, we as a result of the criticisms of human relations approach, behavioral science approach and social systems approach, two of them came into being one by one. Behavioral science approach is a refined form of human relations approach, wherein a systematic study of human behavior was done. So in the Hawthorne studies and in the human relations approach given by Mayo, there was no systematic study. There were only experiments. There was no systematic study on why people are reacting or behaving in a certain way. And in order to carry out that systematic study, you need to go through all these social sciences, which focus on reading and understanding human behavior as an individual, as a group as well. But that was not done in human relations approach. It was purely based on experiment. Behavioral science approach went a step further and decided to link the human relations approach and the focus on humans in the organizations with various studies like psychology, sociology, anthropology, etc., etc., because they felt that the link between systematic studies of humans and human behavior in organizations can give us some good results, some tangible results which can be used in organizations. So that was the entire contribution of behavioral systems approach. The third one is, the next one is social systems approach. The father of social systems approach is Chester Bernard, and the main contribution of social systems school was that organization is a cooperative system, and he gave the term of acceptance authority, wherein he said that PM Modi has authority over Amit Shah, okay, he formally has an authority over Amit Shah, but if Amit Shah does not accept, if he does not accept the authority of PM Modi over Amit Shah, then the authority will have no meaning. That's what Chester Barnard said. He said that authority in itself is not effective till the time it is accepted by the person who is being directed, who is being controlled. Okay, rejection of authority will result in failure of authority system. If Amit Shah here rejects the authority of PM Modi, then the entire structure and function of authority responsibility relationship will completely fall apart. That's what Chester Barnard said. The next evolution was modern organization theory, and after that we had contingency theory. Okay, so the last one is contingency theory. Modern organization theory is a very superior and evolved form of organization theory, which had certain features which still hold a lot of importance, because modern organization theory has evolved in a globalized environment, has evolved in a globalized environment after 1990s. The focus of modern organization theory was that organizations are working in an open system, not a closed system. There is a continuous relationship, there is a continuous interaction with the environment, and therefore organizations cannot work alone. They have to work with other organizations, other influencers, let it be the government, let it be NGOs, let it be anything. The second feature is that they're integrative, which means that it brought together the classical theorist and the neoclassical theorist. The classical theorist focused on structure, the neoclassical theorist focused on social systems or humans, and the modern theory said that both of them hold equal importance in organization, and therefore structure being the formal relationship and social systems being the informal relationships hold equal importance in the organization, and they should be dealt with in an integrated manner rather than in a piecemeal manner. Okay, traditional and neoclassical theorists were prescriptive in nature as per modern organization theory. Prescriptive in nature, what is the meaning of this? It means that they prescribed what is the best way of doing the work, whereas modern organization theory said that there is no one best way of doing every work. There are different ways that which can be used, and unique solutions arise because the problems are unique. Why are the problems unique? The problems are unique because organizations now don't work in a closed system, they work in an open system, which is the first feature of modern organization theory. The features are connected as well. Because organizations work in an open system wherein they are directly and continuously interacting with the environment, therefore the problems which arise are also unique, and the problems are unique, therefore the solutions also have to be unique. Contingency approach added a small thing to modern organization theory. Contingency approach said that organizations need to be situational in their problem solution activity or approach, which means that every situation has some uniqueness, some differentiation, and therefore every situation should be considered individually and should be resolved individually or separately. Okay, so it said that every organization deals with a lot of situations consistently, and every situation is unique, every situation has certain defining moment, certain defining purpose, certain defining feature, and that needs to be understood. Therefore every solution is also going to be different. Okay, so particular action, particular solution will be applicable only in certain conditions, not in every situation or condition. Okay, so this was the major focus of contingency approach. Now there are certain theories on contingency approach, and they are very very important for the simple reason that they are very new in nature. They have just been released in the past 2 to 3 decades, hold a lot of importance because they are still relevant for our type of organizations. Number one is Burns and Stocker study. Burns and Stocker study said that dynamic organizations need to have organic organizational structure, and stable organizations need to have mechanistic organizational structure. So it basically, what it did was that the contingency theory was saying situational. Now Burns and Stocker study organized it, divided into two parts. If you are working in a stable environment, then a mechanistic structure will work for you. But if you are working in a dynamic environment where there are changes happening at every moment, then you need to create an organic organizational structure, otherwise your firm will die. So he organized it further and gave it specific names. Now, certain differences between mechanistic and organic structure, if you don't understand it. Mechanistic, in short form, mechanistic can be something which is rigid in nature, like the military relationships, relationships in the military organizations, relationships in bureaucracy, civil servants, civil services, whereas organic structures are more easy and free flowing. For example, NGOs, you are directly interacting with the CEO also, with the head also, if you're working in an NGO. Research organizations, if you're let's say the CERN study which was being carried out in Switzerland, the interns which were being hired from MITs and various other top colleges were directly interacting with one of the best scientists in the country, and they were working together trying to solve that issue, try to understand the major problem and come out with some discovery. So the major difference between mechanistic and organic is mechanistic is more rigid, mechanistic is more properly defined, the communication is formalized, decision making is centralized, the senior seems to or decides what is to be done, there's a lot of focus on obedience, the subordinate cannot deny what the senior has already told or what the whatever the orders have been, and they are more or less stable. That is the reason that they can actually live with all these features. Whereas organic structures, because the organizations are more unstable, whether it is NGOs, whether it is research organizations, therefore they need to create non-rigid relationships. They need to have decentralized decision-making environment, and the focus has to be more on fulfilling what the organization needs rather than focusing on obedience and operational things like that. Okay, so this was given by Burns and Stocker, under called as Burns and Stocker study. The second one is Emery and Drist. She gave they gave four types of environment. So they further divided. So number one, situational. That is the central theme of contingency theory. Burns and Stocker said stable and dynamic environment. Stable environment, mechanistic; dynamic environment, organic. This was the structure created by Burns and Stocker. Now came Emery and Drist. They said, okay, situational, let's create another kind of division. Four types of organizations: place it randomized, place it clustered, disturbed, reactive, and turbulent field. They are very important. They look difficult, sound difficult, but they have been asked in the examination consistently. Place it randomized. The best example is Indian Railways. The environment is stable, change occurs, but it occurs very slowly. Change is occurring through foreign investment, change is occurring through metros, coming in of metros in the cities, but even then, the environment is highly stable and change is occurring very slowly. Place it clustered. The environment is stable here also, but survival of the organization or of the person is linked to how much an organization or a person knows about its environment. So although environment is stable, but it still is changing, and therefore your survival is determined directly upon how much you are in connection with the environment. The best example here is medical profession. Although it is very stable, you have done your medicine, you've done your MD or MBBS, you're going to earn well, you're going to have a nice life, you're going to be able to find work very easily. There's a lot of demand, a lot of people falling ill, you will always be full of people. So even if you want to do some charity work, there will never be dearth of people. But at the same time, it is changing, and therefore you need to be in touch with your studies, you need to be in touch with your environment, you need to be in touch with the new diseases that are coming up. Otherwise you will fall back, you will not be able to treat people well. The third one is disturbed reactive, wherein an oligopolistic market exists and there is severe competition between firms. The best example is automobile industry. And the final one is turbulent field, wherein the environment is very dynamic, it's changing very fast. The uncertainty is very high, which is not as high in disturbed reactive. And the best example is electronics. Automobile is considerably more stable than electronics. In electronics, every 1 month, the old technology goes out and new technology has to come in. So whatever you created with 1 year of investment, 1 year of or R&D, and you created inventory, it all goes to waste. So you need to understand how dynamic the environment is and how ever changing it is. So we have understood a lot of things about evolution of organization theory, starting from human relations approach all the way to contingency approach. Let's discuss certain questions and then we will move forward in subsequent lessons towards organization structures. The first question is, which of the following is not a feature of classical theory? Which one of the following is not a feature of classical theory? So we just identify which one of these is a feature of classical theory. Study the impact of external environment on working of organizations. Did classical theory talk about external environment at all? No. It assumed that organizations work in a closed system. So this has to be our answer. But let's go through all the other options. Concentrated on organization structure for achievement of organization goals. These are the keywords here. Yes, it did concentrate or focus on organization structure. Science for each element of man's work. Yes, it tried to find out one best way of doing work. Ignored informal elements. Yes, it did ignore informal elements. Did not follow human relation approach. Yes, human relation approach came in as a criticism of classical theory. Therefore, our answer to this question is 1. The next question is, which of the following studies are not a part of Hawthorne, not a part of Hawthorne studies conducted by Mayo? Bank wiring observation, it was. Relay experiment, it was. Illumination experiment, it was conducted. Psychological productivity experiment was not conducted by Hawthorne, not conducted by anyone. It's just a made up name. Okay, let's come to the next question. Which of the following is a limitation of classical organization theory? This one is a tricky question. I would want you to answer that first before I tell you the answer. They are employer focused, keyword. They are employee focused, keyword. They are formal, they provide formal control over ownership, and they do not consider human relation. Yes, D is certainly right. Yes, there is formal control over ownership. So C and D are certainly right. A goes, 1 goes, 2 goes, B and C, 4 also goes. We are left with 3 and 5. Is A also right? They are employer focused. Yes, they are employer focused. They are certainly not focused on the employee. So our answer is A, C and D. Who is considered as father of human relation approach? A very easy question. The answer is George Elton Mayo. George Elton Mayo conducted Hawthorne experiments, in which an illumination experiment was one of them. What were the conclusions of the illumination experiment? What are the conclusions of illumination experiment? Productivity is significantly affected by lighting levels. Is it so? No, it is not. It is affected by the people in the organization or in the department, rather than being affected by physical conditions. Significantly affected by workers' behavior. No correlation with lighting level. Light level has effect on workers' behavior. Psychological relationship between lighting level and employee psychology. Not at all connected. Light level has effect, no effect. Now the confusion is between 2 and 3. 2 says productivity is affected by workers' behavior. 3 says productivity is indirectly related or no correlation. It is not saying indirectly, it is saying no correlation at all with no correlation with the lighting level. The illumination experiment focused on creating a correlation between lighting level and productivity, and it came to the conclusion that there is in fact no correlation. So this is the best answer. Also 2 is also not incorrect, because the result of this was that there is a relationship between workers' behavior and productivity. But this is a better answer, because the primary reason of the study and the primary conclusion was that there is no correlation between productivity and lighting levels. Which approach of organization theory is considered a refined form of human relation approach? Which theory came after human relation approach? Behavioral science approach. So that's our answer. Which approach is followed to explain and predict human behavior through study of psychology, sociology, anthropology? Which one started with a systematic study of human behavior? It was behavioral science approach. So our answer is 3. Which of the following is a feature of contingency theory? So the focus of contingency theory was action orientation and situational. Problems in an organization are dealt in an integrated manner rather than piecemeal manner. This approach is action oriented. Yes, it is. Only a particular theory can be applied in a given situation. No, different kinds of theories can be applied in a given situation depending upon the situation. There must be scientific rule for each and every work and non-flexibility. No, it is not. Managerial actions and organizational design must be appropriate to the given situation. Yes, this is correct. So B and E are certainly correct. C and D are certainly wrong. You remove this, you remove this, you remove this. You have A, B and E, and you have A only, which is also not correct. So the answer is through elimination A, B and E. Yes, it is integrated because contingency theory was an addition to modern organization theory. It was not completely separate. Therefore, whatever features existed in the modern organization theory were taken over to contingency theory also. Which of the following are features of mechanistic structure of organization, which basically means classical studies? Decision making is decentralized? No, it is centralized in mechanistic structure. High degree of differentiation of functional tasks is there? We don't know, we are not very sure. Rights and obligations are defined? Yes. Rigid hierarchical relationships? Yes. So C and D are certainly right, A is certainly wrong. Suitable where environment is dynamic, uncertain and unstable? No. So wherever we have E, we remove it. Okay. And wherever we have A, we remove that also. A is also removed. So we are left with only B, C and D. C, D and B. There is high degree of differentiation of functional tasks. That is something new that we have learned, also part of mechanistic structure. High differentiation of functional tasks so that they can be clear authority responsibility relationship. According to Emery Interest, where there is severe competition between firms and there is oligopolistic market structure, then which type of environment is prevailing? Oligopolistic came under disturbed reactive. So our answer is 3, disturbed reactive. Okay. So this is all for today's session where I talked about different organization theories starting from the human relations approach. In the last session we talked about the classical theorist. From the next session we are going to move forward and talk about organization structures, which also form a part of principles of management. Okay, I hope you liked the lesson. If you did, do not forget to subscribe to the channel, press the bell icon and stay in touch with me regularly so that we are able to clear the exam as fast as possible. All the very best. Take